Good morning, and thank you for joining us for In My Creative Classroom with Ronaldo Lawrence. I'm delighted to have this opportunity to introduce you to Ronaldo. Hi, Ronaldo.
Hi there.
Hi. So again, my name is Emily Seamus. I'm with the Adobe Education team, and I'll be your host today. Just to kick things off, I want to tell you a little bit about this series. So In My Creative Classroom was developed as an opportunity for us to feature some of the very creative Adobe Education leaders in our community. And Ronaldo is very generously offered to spend an hour with us today to tell us a little bit about himself, his work, and his creative journey, and what brought him to this point as both a creator and an educator. So the great thing about these sessions is that they're fairly informal in nature, and we're going to kick things off with an interview that I'll do with Ronaldo, and then we'll spend the bulk of the session with Ronaldo giving us a presentation and walking us through some of his ideas, creative projects, lessons, and just giving us an opportunity to virtually visit his classroom. So just a little bit of housekeeping. We're recording this session so we can share it with others later on the Adobe Education Exchange. We also have two chat boxes open. One is just for general conversation. Please feel free to use that space to introduce yourself. And we also have a pod that will follow us a bit that's specific questions for Ronaldo. And throughout the session, I'll keep an eye on both those areas just to make sure that your questions are highlighted so that you can exchange information with Ronaldo as well. So without further ado, I just want to give you a little more background information about our fabulous speaker today. Ronaldo Lawrence teaches and develops interactive learning resources at Chiswick School in London, England. As part of this work, he collaborates with the teachers at a school, and he uses their curriculum actually to create interactive multimedia content. He's also a really skilled trainer and consultant, and he speaks across the US and Europe about how to develop really engaging and creative digital content. In addition to that, as I mentioned, Ronaldo is an Adobe Education leader. He's also a speaker and author on lynda.com, as well as an Apple Distinguished Educator, a Microsoft Innovative Educator, and educator trainer, and a lecturer at Westminster Universities in London. So today he's here to talk about his work in all those areas, as well as the work he does as an advanced skills teacher. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Ronaldo. And Ronaldo, why don't you kick us off by just telling us a little bit more about you and your creative journey?
Sure. First of all, Kevin and Wolfgang, thank you guys, Peter, so much for joining us. My journey is a sort of strange journey in that I never thought I would touch a computer. Matter of fact, I couldn't even spell computer. I started playing basketball. I played at the University at Appalachian State University. I'm from South Carolina. I played for a guy called Bobby Cremins, who's in the Hall of Fame. I then was drafted by the Clippers, and when I got cut, I just came to Europe. And one day I was just sitting in a class, well, actually sitting in a network manager's office, and he had Microsoft Word open, and he had a program called Draw, and he just dragged an image from Draw into Microsoft Word, and it just blew my mind. The next week, I went out and bought a computer. And just so happened, as things would have it, the young lady who was the head of IT said to me that she was pregnant and she was leaving, and no one knew at the moment. So, what I did was I went around to all the departments of school, asked them if they could have an internet site or an intranet site, what would they have? And they gave me the stuff. And so, I spent literally, and I mean literally, every day after school in the library teaching myself how to use a computer and how to build this stuff. So when I built the intranet site, when the job came up, because I had been doing the job, they decided that, hey, well, we might as well give him the job. And I then stayed there and I went to another school where I became an advanced skills teacher. And I'm now at Chiswick School where I work and deploy interactive content for teachers, which I will show you some of today.
Fantastic. Thank you, Ronaldo. I was wondering if you could tell me a little bit about sort of your creative background. It's interesting to hear that you thought you'd never use a computer. What else sort of has What are some of your other creative passions in life in general, and sort of how do you bring that to the classroom?
Sure, basketball was my life. Basketball was everything to me. And I think what basketball did for me, because I was very fortunate to play at such a high level, and I played in played England. I'm the what am I? I'm the fourth leading scorer in the history of British basketball. Scored 73 in the game, so the Guinness Book of Records. And I think all of this allowed me and showed me how to play with people, how to get along with people, because when you're on the team and you want to win, you can't just be solo. But I think then you have moments of creativity when you have the opportunity to score a lot, or you have the opportunity to showcase your abilities. And I think a lot of that translated into the classroom for me, because the huge thing in the classroom for me is not just about them learning particular skills. It's about them growing up to be young men and young women when they leave me. But the most important thing to me, other than that, is that I've given them the tools, both socially, emotionally, and skill-wise, in order to deal with society and deal with the world that they're going to go out into. And I think it's extremely important that I put in front of them the tools that are valuable tools. And there are no more valuable tools, to be honest, than the Adobe tools. I mean, there are no more. And so we have the Creative Cloud. I had to fight tooth and nails to get it, but I got it. And we have it on laptops. And so I have about 13, 14 young people who I work with in year 12 and 13, and which they use the Creative Cloud on the laptops. And to me, it's the best thing going, because I know when they leave me and they go in any organization that they will use some of those tools.
Great.
The other strange thing is, and I don't know where the heck this came from, but when I see billboards and I see books and I see posters, I see animation. I actually see things moving. And I think that plays a big part, and that helps me a lot when I'm looking at the teacher's curriculum and actually creating content for them. That's pretty much how that happened, Emily.
Great, great. And then, how do you keep, I think part of sports and part of creativity, you're constantly adapting and learning new skills and practicing.
Yes.
So on the creativity side, how do you actually continue to develop your skills that you use with your students? Where do you go for creative education and additional training?
The issues that I have are, I don't think, are dissimilar to a lot of teachers. The content that they actually train you in school is, some of it of very little use to me. So a lot of my training comes during the summers when we attend the Adobe Educational Summit. And that's when I'm around the most creative people I know in this world. And so I look at projects that they're doing, and I look at projects that individuals are doing within that group. And when I see them do things, things just spark off for me. So I pick up a lot of things that they do, which is really interesting, some of the projects they do. But I also think lynda.com is like a huge thing for me. I spend the majority of my time when I'm trying to learn something on lynda.com, because you can find just about anything that you want there. And so I spend the majority of my time there. All the other stuff is, I think they're so sick of me in the library. I live in the library, and I read a lot. And in my bookshelf, I probably have just about every Creative Cloud book there is. So I spend a lot of time, because I'm working with a lot of teachers. They have different needs and different wants, so it's very important that I understand and know how to use various applications in order to sort of make sure that I can meet those needs.
Great. Thanks for sharing that.
Ooh.
So, tell us a little bit about your strategies when you're collaborating with other educators. How do you
Yeah.
bring them into your process and then help them find their own creative voice?
Yeah, that's really interesting, that, because for the most part, people don't know what they want, for the most part, because they don't know what they want because they don't know what's possible. So it's my job to try to show them what's possible. And when I was first there, when I first went, and the head the guy who's the head teacher, had me stand up in front of everybody. And I created some stuff over the summer, which I'll show you some of the stuff today. And I showed them that, and they looked at me like I was absolutely crazy. No one seemed to be able to grasp it. However, the next day, I was shocked when I had at least 15 people come to me and say they wanted to work on projects. So what we then did was we made a list of people who I could work with. And the process works something like this. What I will do is I will work with the teachers. They will show me their curriculum. What I will do is I will then divide that curriculum up with them into sections. So like the starter, the main section of the lesson and the plenary. And then what we will look at and try to decide is what type of multimedia, if need any, to go in there, we will put in there. And so what then happens when we decide that, I will then arrange time where I can record the teacher. I shoot video with the teacher. I then edit all that. We put together everything and then we present it to the teacher. We then test it out on some students to make sure that it's applicable. Once they have agreed that it's okay, the teacher's comfortable with it, she will teach it in a lesson. And then whatever needs to be adjusted, I will then adjust it, fix it, and then we give it to them for final. And then they will give everything out to the students, and we go from there. That's pretty much the process.
Great. Thanks. Well, this might be a good place to actually transition into looking at more of your materials. Would this be a good time to switch over to your presentation?
One of the ones I want to show you now, which is very interesting, is that we have okay, if I come show you my desktop here, I've got whatever we do is we trying to create content for every device, because I need to make sure that parents, students, teachers, everybody can use the content. So one of the things that we have in my school is every single student at Key Stage 3, which is I think 11 to 13, has an iPad. So what the primary thing I do is I create content for the iPad. Some parents have been to me and wanted content for Android devices, so I do that also. So one of the ones I wanted to show you now and walk you through is we have a teacher who is a music teacher. And what she wanted to do was she wanted to digitize the whole curriculum for the music department. So we sat down, went through the process that I've mentioned before, and this is what we created. One of the huge problem I think that teachers have with students is around the language of the particular subject area that they're trying to study. Because kids need to understand the language if they're going to understand what the subject area is about. So one of the things we
This
do.
is important. This will help you understand key words for the unit. Please tap the audio symbols for
Is we create an audio dictionary with all the language around the curriculum. And that's the first thing we pretty much put in just about all the books. So if I click on any
Word
one of these.
diagrams, pictures to describe where you place your fingers. Fingerboard, where you place your fingers. Fret, the way the neck is divided.
So that has played a big part in helping the teacher keep her sanity, in terms of always trying to explain what various things means. So we do that. Here we then have the rules for the classroom, the objectives of the scheme of work. If we come on through, we then have the levels. So what levels that so the kids would know what levels they are. If we come on through here, this is a task that they have to do. So one of the things that we do is we try to make sure that we supply the kids with enough content to help them understand what they're supposed to do. So the teacher will go through this. If the kids need some support, what they can do is touch here. And they will have a video for some support. And the video will go through some of the content that's actually in the document they have to read. Now, the other bit that's very important for the teacher is to understand that the kids have actually understood what she's tried to deliver to them. So the way that we do that is we use Google Forms. So what happens is when the students are actually finished, they come in, they fill in the form, we teach the teachers how to use the forms. They then click submit. Once they click submit on here, then the teacher gets the information, and he or she can actually ascertain who has actually understood what they needed to understand during the course of that lesson or the particular unit area. If we come on through, one of the big problems that she had was all the students, or the majority of them, were losing their music sheets when they were walking in the classroom. So there was a negative atmosphere even before the lesson even started. So she wanted to put all the sheets one place. So if you notice here, we have all the sheets at one single place here, so the two students can come through and use that like they need to. Here we have some chords, some music. At the bottom, we have a barcode. So if one of the students asks to come in and he or she has forgotten the iPad, or the iPad has died and there's something they need to do, what they can do is, because all the kids have phones, they can scan it and actually bring up what they need to view on their phone. And in this case, I think it's just a simple web page that they can go through, and she can show them what she needs to show them. I'm on through here. Again, we have more chords and all the music that they need. If I come on through here, again, the chords, if I come on through here, what we have here, this is a form that the students need to do. And on down here, they need to know the different parts of the ukulele. So what they have here is for themselves, it's just a drag and drop where they can actually drag the different parts in here and then click submit. And the submit will actually tell them whether they've got it all right or they need to go back and try again. On through again, this is a delayed piece of audio that she wanted, because she wanted the kids to play the piece first and then listen. So that should play a little audio piece in a moment. On through, and then we have the evaluation section where the kids then evaluate what they've done, and then the teacher can really get a grasp of what sort of knowledge that the students have had. And then we've got some support video there. And the beautiful thing about this is that if we click here, students can jump to any part that they want to jump to. So differentiation becomes extremely easy for the teacher. They also have a menu here that they can jump back and forth the way they need to jump to. So that's that one. The next one I'd like to show you is I'd like to show you the geography one, because with the geography one, with that department, what we've done is we have tried to, it's the wrong one. We've tried to make sure, I'm sorry, we've tried to make sure that all the content that we've created, as I said before, that we've done it on all the devices. Come on. So here it is here. So if I click on here, you can see everything looks pretty much the same from here. So if we come back, I turn this one sideways like that and leave it here. So you can see here, everything pretty much looks the same. So if we come on to the next page, and again here, this is a table of contents, which is slightly different here. Students can come up and down and find what they want. If they click on, say, for instance, here, what they can then do is jump to the video. And then the video will go through with them what they need or what parents need to understand. I stop that, if I come on through here, then what we've got is we've got a live map here. And then if I come on through, this turns different ways. So this is a little bit of animation. Then on through here is we have the lesson content. So in here we have an introduction, and then down here, this explains to the kids what they need to do. So if you touch any of these, what happens is that there's a video that walks them through how to use particular applications. The difference on the phone, so that was the iBook bit. So if I show you this one right here, this is the one that comes through, and you can see here again, you have the table of contents for the iPhone. If I come on through, you have the video here. And then if I come on through here, we have the live map like we had before. And then this is where it changes. If we come to this page right here, you will notice that it sort of differs. The difference on the phone is that if a student forget to download a particular app, they can touch on one of the apps and they can download the app to their phone straight away. So they're not missing any of the learning. But with these, we have all the lessons. So if I come through to the next page here, and these are where the lesson starts. So we have the beginning of the lesson. 21 is not playing. We have the beginning of the lesson. And here you have the same thing.
Learning objective, to investigate collecting the world. Today what we're doing is looking
and that
at
goes
how
from
we're...
beginning to end. So we have the first video that supports the learning from the beginning all the way down to the plenary, which is when the teacher is actually closing
how
the lesson off.
The learning from today's lesson.
If we come on through, again, we have many more lessons on here that the students can actually have access to. And the one that I showed you before was an iBook. So on through here, if I come on through, again, we have much more on the iPad version because the students will access it on the iPad version more. So they have different tasks that they have to complete here. If I come on through again, some more lessons. And then on through, these are the documents that they need for any parts of the lesson. So what we've done is embed everything that the students need. The benefit of this is that when you have parent-teacher nights, it's amazing the sort of interaction you have between parents and teachers then, because you don't have to try to, or the parents don't have to try to guess what you're talking about. They can actually see what you're talking about. So this right here, I think this is the PowerPoint presentation about the mystery one that they will go through. So if I come on through here, this is about maps on through. If I touch here, we have a video about maps. On down, we have a task for the students to actually complete about different maps. When they have finished the particular first task, if they finish, what they can do is they can have extension tasks like that, so they can finish off what they need to do. On the side here, we have different objects that they need to touch with instructions here. So what we're trying to do is trying to make the kids as independent as possible. On through, so if I come back to here, so that's that one. Emily, are there any questions yet so far? Anyone have any questions about anything?
I'll keep an eye on the chat and discussion just in case for you.
Okay, I've gone through. The next one I want to show, which is quite interesting, is we wanted to try to keep, an almost like environment where the students were not neglected because we were in the city. So one of the things we wanted to do was we wanted to show them things like the rainforest. Well, sort of difficult in the city showing them the rainforest unless you take them out of school. So one of the things we wanted to do was create an environment within the app that would sort of mirror the rainforest. So when the students come in, again, this is for geography. If they come in, we have all the sounds of the rainforest. If we touch here, these are two very famous guys here who actually are with a show in the rainforest. So the kids immediately have some identification of what the rainforest is because they know and they've seen those guys actually in the rainforest with some different celebrities. We come on through here, we have a table of contents. On through here, we have the big picture. And if you notice that we have a lot of audio all through, where the kids can stop going through. Here, we have some video that the teachers actually ad-lib over. If I come on through here, this is about a map. So what has to happen is the students are doing some collaborative work. So the students will need to figure out the answers of the questions using a map. So what they can do is on the side, they can pull this out. They have the map there. They can see what they need to do, put the map back, and actually go through the content. If we come on through, what we've got here is we can pause. And then what we've got here, I think our students are being tested so much. So what we tried to do was create an environment that they could test themselves, and no one else had to know whether they got it right or wrong. And sometimes it's best to learn that way. So here's a drag and drop where the students can actually just drag and drop the actual answers onto and then click submit to check the answers. And here the teacher wanted to do some collaborative work. And so we have three videos in here, in which he split the group up into the three into three separate groups, and they had to answer worksheets. So on the first video, the second video,
birds can spend their entire lives of being never touching the ground.
In the third video,
they are cutting ants,
I think the thing that really sets home for me is that the kids feel really engaged with the content. And no longer do they just sit and look in static books and try to imagine what things are. They can actually see what things are. Now, one of the things here is that students needed to create a postcard of their experience, and then they would send the postcards, a real postcard home. But a lot of kids have no idea what postcards look like. So what we've done is we've embedded a postcard in here so they can actually see what the postcard looked like. Then on through, if they have here an evaluation form that they have to fill out, then they can then show their knowledge of what they've actually learned from the teacher from there. Okay, what I like to do now is I like to just sort of come over to iBooks. Now, one of the things we wanted to do was because we think that a lot of the issues are, and if you notice here, I have the iBook on the iPhone, and we've got it here. One of the things that tends to happen is that parents tend to be the forgotten people when you're creating all your assets for your teachers, I mean, for your students. So what we wanted to do was we wanted to create a book that would actually help parents learn. So if you flip through here, this is a book where we have the head talking.
Welcome to the GE iPad lecture. In this section, our objective is to explain why you should use the iPad.
If we come on through here, and what we've got is some objectives. And then through here, what we wanted the parents to do was to be able to touch on any one of these and actually see what the different parts of the device do. Because a lot of them were very afraid of the device and unsure of how to use it. So we wanted to teach them the different parts of the device. I'm on through here, the objectives in creating folders. What we wanted to do from here is we wanted to create tutorials for the parents. We wanted to show parents exactly how to use the devices so they didn't feel so alienated from their kids. I'm on through here on what we've got is I want to show you now some of the stuff that I do in my classroom. So in my classroom, what I have is we have my students. So this is the site that they use pretty much for everything that we do. We have a mission statement that we sort of agree on at the beginning. We have resources that they can access. And then all the lessons are pretty much laid out the same. So if I come here, what you can see here is you can actually see how the lessons are laid out. If I come down, you see we have the lessons up top. On the side, what we have is we have the syllabus, we have all the content that they need. They can download the lesson plan. Here we have a mobile site if they need to use a mobile site and access it on their phones. That is a cut down version, obviously, and it would look like a mobile site on their actual phones. On down for each part of the lessons, what we have is we have a video to introduce what they need to do.
The third thing we will do is we will look at the room layout and our ceiling plan. The fourth thing we will do is I will take you through the group of resources.
The other thing that I thought was important because sometimes kid, not everybody is there, or sometimes when you hear content, you don't remember. So what I've done is I've created the lesson beforehand
Welcome
that the
to your
students can
lessons
actually.
one and two tutorial.
So all they need to do is come through.
In this presentation, we will look at this in the first part of our course. You will need to have a real client.
And they can actually learn straight away. You know, they don't have to worry about missing the lesson if they couldn't help it, you know, so they can do that. We also have where it says meeting room or connect room that we can meet if they have issues. We haven't really used that. I think I've used it twice this year. So if the kids forget something or don't know how to do something, if we're on vacation, then they can, I give them a certain time and they can come in and we can talk about things. We have the lesson objectives. And we also have all the keywords, lesson starters. We have all the sheets. And then we get down, that's the starter here. So that goes through and explains to them.
Explain to me what you know about multilingual development. Give me an example.
We have the criteria, what they need to do for the first part. And then we get down to the main part of the lesson here. And again, they go through the main bit.
The main task. During this lesson, we will discuss the different principles of multimedia development.
I'm on down. If you go, we have the stretch activity. They have examples of the different tools that they will use so they can click through to another site to see how that tool is valuable to use. And then we have extension work. So if they have done everything that I need them to do, then what we do is if we can go to another part of the same lesson or if they can go to the next lesson, they can go ahead and actually go through the plenary and actually do different sections. So the idea is that we always try to make sure that the students are not just sitting around waiting for me. And we try to make them as independent as possible. And down here, we have a Prezi presentation. As you can see here, go ahead.
It was a good question that this might be a good time to insert. Ronaldo's wondering, are the kids' results stored and evaluated? And if so, do you use any other tools like Google or quizzes that might help you assess their success with these lessons?
I don't really need to use an evaluative tool like that, but what we do use, all the kids' work is on Google Drive. Everything is on Google Drive, so they share the folder with me. So when I'm marking, I leave comments and everything, and I go through their work, we leave comments. So we do it that way. And when we get ready to have, say, senior management or them for us to be assessed how we are marking the kids, we just share the folder with them. And then they can go through and they can see all the notes and everything that we've written to the students and everything. So we pretty much do it that way with the older kids. Okay?
All right. Thank you. Yep.
So if we go on through here, we have, again, the different lessons. Now, again, that's not, I think that's great, but not everybody learn in one way. So the other way that we're doing here now is they can access the content on the devices also. So if I come here, again, they can come through and they've got everything that they need. So if I come through here, they've got a table of contents. Come through here. This is the, come on through here. Then this is the introductory lesson. So if I come through here, we've got some audio to explain to them what they need to do. And if we come on through here, again, we have the syllabus. And if they need amplification of the syllabus, they can pull that out and understand what needs to go in each of the particular sections. So we try to provide them with as much information, again, so they can be as independent as possible. It doesn't always work, of course, but at least if the information is there, they can have a go at it. And if we come on through, again, we have all the lessons. We have the starters, the videos again. If we come down here, we have an introduction of something that they need to do. And if we come on down here, we have worksheets for the students. So if they click there, then they have the worksheets and everything they need to do. So this is all the work that they need to fill out. So all the videos, all the content support them creating and filling out that document. I'm on through. Again, we have the main task. This is a help sheet. One of the Adobe help sheets that the students use to go through. We also have down here, in order to help them again, we have amplification of what they might need to do. What we've got is we've got the different sections that they need to actually learn about and go through. On the phone, if we come on through, again, they have all the videos. And what I do is I put all the videos up on YouTube so the kids can have access to them. And then in here, we have a lot of the different links that they can have. On through here, again, all the lessons are structured the same. Again, we have the barcode. These are examples of what they need to do. If they come to attend one of those, they can see examples of the tasks that they need to complete. Down through here, again, they have the situation where they need to jump to any particular part or any lesson, that they can jump to any part or any lesson like that. So we try to ensure that that's what's happening with them. The other thing I like to show you is quite interesting, at least I think it's quite interesting, because I'm going to sort of switch this around. I work with the different language departments, and if you try to imagine that you've got parents who have students who, year seven students, so their first year in big school, and they're coming in and they don't speak any other language, and the parents don't speak any language. So what you're trying to do is trying to teach the kids, then you're trying to ask the parents to support the kids. Nightmare. So what we've done is we've created some different apps for French and German. So if you come through, what we have is we have a book, and inside the book we have chapters. So you can touch on any one of these links here, and this will take you to one if you touch on the teacher. In this presentation, we're going to look at how to say when this. Slide one. This. Slide two. You come on down here, it goes through that they can see the answers. If we go to the next section here, what happened in here is that they're talking about pets.
Now we're going to talk about house theorem.
And what we wanted to do is we wanted to make it interactive and fun for the kids. So if they touch any of the animals. If we come on down, these are tasks that the kids have to do in their book, and we got an explanation of everything. Once they've done that, and they can come down and then check whether they've got it right or wrong themselves instead of waiting for the teacher to mark their books. So they can go back and do that. I'm on down here. Again, they have more information. We have videos. If we come on down, then we have some other content here too. On down, if we click here, they can see the list of positives and negatives. So they can pretty much come through, and this is about the family. So they can come down here and they can touch and learn how to say the different. On through, if we come on through here, and then this one is about school. So what we've got is we've got all the audio where they can learn how to say the various bits. On down, if they touch any one of these, you can see the word that actually comes out in English. So they can test themselves. If we come down on here, what you can see, if you touch any one of the pieces of food. And on down, they have the drinks. And so on. And I think these, it will show the actual jumper. So they have different parts of clothing. That will actually show the different parts of clothing. And so the kids find it very interesting. There they are at the bottom. The kids find it very interesting because they can actually go away in groups and they don't have to have the teacher with them all the time. And these are the different colors and so on. I come back out of here. There's one or two more I want to show you. What we wanted to do in the library is we wanted to get the kids to read certain books, but we didn't want to tell them that these were the books that we wanted them to read. And there were some on lists that were highly, lists that were, you know, the government wants the kids to read. So what we decided to do was create a Chizik Book Choice app. So what happens is we have students reviewing books and then students referring books to other students instead of teachers saying that this is great or whatever. So a kid will read a book and then give a synopsis of the book. So if we come
Welcome
on through
to
here.
Welcome to the Chizik Book Choice.
So these are the librarians. If we come on through the here. We have a small video about reading books. And all this was done in After Effects, Photoshop in After Effects. And so if we finish that, if we come on through, then what happens is here, these are the books right here. So if the students want to know about the books, they touch on the audio file. On down so they can touch on the audio file. And if they want to find out about the author, they click about the author so they can actually see who the author is. We have a collection of books now, but we are slowly adding on. So this is the second page here. We're slowly adding on to the collection of books. And the books can only be recommended by other students.
Story is about Sally Lockhart.
At least they think they are being introduced by other students. The teachers are actually helping them make decisions, but they don't know that. Okay, and the last thing I would like to show you is the French book. So this is the French book here. With the French book, what happens is, again, it's very much you have the table of contents. You come to where you need to come to. If you come down, we have video for parents to give parents an understanding. All that's After Effects. You come on down here, the teacher can explain. On down, we then have all the tasks, and each of the slides have audio. We also have support, and we have extensions. So the teacher, if she needs to explain the extension, she has it there. If you touch on any one of the sheets like that, what that will do is bring up a Google document where the students have to evaluate what they, or show their knowledge in there. If we come on down again, we have, again, the books, what they use, the reading tasks. If we come on to the side here, they have a tab that they can pull out where they learn the different reading symbols. If they come on down here, they've got tasks to do. So when they come here, in order to see the task, this is the task they need to do. And then down here, the neat thing is that they have support. They have extension work, stretch work, they call it there. And then down here to find the answers, they can just touch here and they can find the answers from a task. And what she wanted to do also was she wanted to get, well, I'll let her explain. So she wanted them to describe each person in the family tree. So what we've done is we have, again, we have stretch, we have support. And if the students come on down, when they have guessed what they're going to say and they want to check the answers, they can then click the plus sign. So what they can then do, if they touch on any one of the characters, the box will come out. And if they want to hear about whether they got it right, they can actually listen to the language of what was actually being said. And again, and if they close it down here, that will go back and then they can have another guess. And on down, we have also different languages and everything here. So, and then we have jobs, we have pull-out tab, and this is where the kids have to describe the various bits of the job. So they touch any one, they come up and touch any one of the audio files. On down. You can imagine if you have SEN students or statement of students and they're trying to learn, or even advanced kids can go off and they don't actually need the teacher. So if you touch any of the images, and on down, and so you have a lot of different tasks that they have to go through and complete. This right here, if you touch that, that will actually say the word, which is supposed to do, and then on through, we have more jobs, again, with the pull-out tab. And then on down, they have various tasks. The one interesting thing down here, they can touch one of these, they can then close it up to see the actual word or what was supposed to be. Okay, so I think in conclusion, I think one of the things that we're trying to do is we're trying to ensure that we have all of our students with content that can help make them self-sufficient. And so my job is working with all the other teachers in order to try to make sure that I can help them do that. Because I think a huge part of what goes on now is that parents' involvement. And we try to get parents involved as much as possible. So again, no more do parents need to just come and say, well, yeah, I think I know what you're talking about. They can actually see what their students are learning. And so that's where we're going, Emily, and that's how it is.
Great. And that's something that that I noticed in that, and so did Wolfgang. It's just so great the way that you've incorporated and integrated parents into the lessons. It just makes that connection so seamless between what's going on at school and what's going on at home. Wolfgang actually had another interesting question about those lessons, and I know you developed them for the educators at Chiswick. Do you develop any lessons that you can share outside of your school now, or are there things, other resources you might direct people to that could help them develop some of their own?
No, we tend not to, because that the whole idea of me coming there was to try to make the content bespoke and try to make the content based around what we want to do. I mean, what we want our kids to do. I work with some other schools doing some of the stuff, but not really. Can I just share one other thing and share one other story, Emily?
Sure. Yep.
Yeah, let me just share one other story. We have a group of students. And what happened was the teacher, they were going to Russia. And we had a mini parent revolt because the year 12 students were going to have the exams in 3 weeks. So the parents weren't sure whether the kids should actually go. So the guy who's the head of history came to me and said, what can we do? So what we did is we sat down and we broke all of the content up into mini booklets for all the devices. So what the kids can do now is that the kids can actually, when they went to Russia, they had all the content that they actually needed. To do. So they had the teacher, to touch the teacher. And it's the same thing on the device here.
I'll make sure that you understand this fully before going in.
And then the other thing we did was let me just show you here. We created all the content and put it online so they had access to the web.
Good morning, everybody. This is a revision PowerPoint for Year 12 History.
And the beautiful thing about here is that they have down here the paperclip that he could attach to differentiate the work with the students. And the kids could just click through. And when they click through, they could just listen to any particular task. And I was so pleased to hear that the kids got the best results the school ever got when they used this. And we've actually some of the links that I shared with you, we've actually put some of the content up on various news venues here or avenues here to share with people how we've done it. So there, that kind of thing I do. I write a lot of articles about what we do so they can be shared. But as far as the content tend not to be shared.
Great. And thank you for mentioning that, Ronaldo, because I will be sending out to all the participants in our webinar an email that will include a link to an Education Exchange resource page, which will include the materials, you know, links to the articles he just mentioned, links to Ronaldo's other webinars that he's done about these topics, so that you'll have that as reference.
And that's my email address. You know, I, as Wolfgang knows, I will help anyone. I don't mind, you know, and the idea is to try to make sure that, because you know what's happening? Every day that goes by, we're getting older, and these kids, we're getting older, and they're going to be the people that run the country. And if we got some illiterate kids, we're going to be in trouble. So we better make sure that these teachers understand how to use multimedia so we can teach these kids when they get out here to get good jobs so they can make sure when we're old, we're okay, you know? So I am more than willing to help anyone.
Well, thank you. Very generous of you, and I know very much appreciated. Are there any other questions you guys have for Ronaldo? Thank you, Wolfgang. We're really glad we could have you. So are there any other comments you'd like to make in closing, Ronaldo? I think you've done an amazing job here. Just watching your presentation was fascinating. I love seeing all the material you've developed. It's just so smooth and exciting. Anything else you'd like to share before we go?
Yeah, I just would like to say is I think that I've been now on Twitter. My handle on Twitter is at Lawrence Ronaldo. I have been putting a lot of content up there and with valuable tips for teachers. Also on LinkedIn, I write quite a few articles on LinkedIn about various things. So, you know, I would be happy, again, if you just follow me, you'll find a lot of content about what I'm doing. And because everything that I do, I try to share.
And so, what again was your Twitter address?
It's at Lawrence Ronaldo. So I'll write it here. So it's at And if you just go to LinkedIn and just do a search for me, and at lynda.com is and there we have about, at the moment, 3 courses. I'm writing 2 more courses to do this summer. And all of my courses are around getting teachers to use multimedia in the classroom.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Pleasure.
Okay.
Thank you, Wolfgang, for hanging out. I really appreciate it.
Yes, thank you. So again, I will post an exchange resource page summarizing many of the things that Ronaldo covered today, or at least providing you the links that you need to get more information. Keep in mind that we have more upcoming sessions of In My Creative Classroom, as well as other webinars coming up, and I encourage you to go to edX to check out the schedule. I'll put it. I'll put our website address right here for you. You can go to edx.adobe.com and check out professional development resources, including these live events, as well as the seminars and courses we offer. But just one last time, I'd like to thank Ronaldo. Thank you, Wolfgang, for coming today. Thank you, everyone else who's listening to our recorded session. I hope you enjoyed this session as much as I did, and I look forward to hearing from you again soon. I'll leave the meeting window open if you have any final questions for Ronaldo. But if not, have a great day. Thanks, Ronaldo.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.